So now we're going to move on to services technologies, which can be a game changer in accelerating the pace at which businesses adopt digital tools and embrace the digital revolution. To show us the way, we have with us keynote speaker Terry Jones, founder of Travelocity.com and a founding chairman of Kayak.com. The topic is services rethinking, how to effectively help digital transformation with evolving services technologies. Please put your hands together to welcome him on stage.
Well, thanks and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here to talk about services technology in the midst of the biggest business disruption we've ever had. Leaders are worried. They're worried because they've seen disruption in music, in hotels, in limos, and in payments. It's critical to understand today that selling and buying and making have changed forever because of the last 12 months. We've had 6 years of digital transformation in just a year of elapsed time. And maybe while you were in quarantine, you missed a few things. Have you heard that song from Hamilton? What did I miss? Remember when Jefferson comes back after 7 years in France? Well, did you miss that Shell announced peak oil? They're never gonna pump as much oil as they did in 2019, and now they're installing 50,000 electric car chargers? Did you miss that GM announced the end of the internal combustion engine in just 15 years? And that Tesla's worth more than the next 10 car companies combined? You remember this song?
Tuppence safely invested in the bank will compound.
The bank used to be where money was safe. Mass Mutual just bought 100 million in Bitcoin. 150 year old insurance company. China, the country that invented money, just launched the first government-backed digital currency. JP Morgan, Jamie Dimon says that fintech is an enormous competitor to banks. And I'll tell you how big a competitor. Banks are way behind. My daughter applied for a mortgage just before COVID. And when the banker was reviewing her finances, he said, "Who is this Mr. Venmo you keep sending money to?" Talk about out of touch, right? Streaming just passed 1 billion subscribers. And Facebook, Amazon, and Google now control half of ad dollars. The madmen have gone to the bar. They have nothing to do, right? The FAA approved drone delivery during COVID. And 30% of doctor visits during COVID were via telemedicine. Amazon now employs over 1 million people, and e-commerce is up 50%. We've seen huge disruption. Look at the disruption just from one new technology, self-driving vehicles. Of course, that's going to disrupt truck drivers. But what about insurance, moving from actuarial data to actual data about each of us? What about parking? You're not going to park anymore. You're going to send your car home and call it back when you need it. Auto repair? If your car is electric like mine, there's not much to fix. 5 years owning a Tesla, I've never had it serviced. Real estate, redesigned. Deliveries, reimagined. Hotels, honey, let's just sleep in the car. We're almost to Vegas. We sleep in airplanes, why not in cars? Healthcare, the number three reason for emergency room visits is car wrecks. They're gonna go down dramatically. Outdoor advertising, multi-billion dollar business. Who's gonna look out the window? Your kids already don't, you won't either. And even traffic cops, who are you gonna arrest? Elon? So all this disruption just from one new technology. Now I'm gonna go pretty fast here. So I've got a little website, tbjones.com/live. I'll show that several times during the presentation. You can download the slides here if you want them. So let's start with a little history before we get into services to know where we came from. I started my IT career 40 years ago. That was IT phase one, systems of record. Systems that added up the sales and made the reservations and created the financials. And if you wanted to take a disk drive on an airplane, you needed a lift truck, right? And what changed, of course, was connectivity. The internet, very cheap connectivity, gave us information everywhere. But we kind of forget at the beginning of the internet age, information only flowed one way. Remember some of you when you had to type the URL in, you had to know it, and then you got a little bit of information back? That's why the first page of Yahoo looked like this, and the first page of Travelocity looked like that. And there was another reason. Remember that? It was slow. It was really, really slow, and yet that limited connectivity equaled huge opportunity. It created IT phase two, systems of engagement. Systems where the first time our computer system engaged with our customers rather than salespeople. A tremendous disruption. It disrupted the music business. It went from the album to buy the song, maps that went to digital and free, books that went to digital and cheap, encyclopedias that went from digital and cheap and free. And then we got more speed, right? And we got a two-way interaction on the internet with that more speed. And users began to create information. And they made it flow in two directions. So people started writing and selling and rating. My friend Rich Barton, who started Expedia and Glassdoor and Zillow, says, if it can be rated, it will be rated. What disrupted that two-way internet? Hotels went to sharing. Photography went to free and sharing. Limos went to sharing and cheap. News went to sharing and free. Software went to free and ad-based. And now we move to another disruption. Increasing capacity and speed and deeply reduced costs for processor, storage, and network took us to IT phase three, where we are now. Connected systems of insight that allow us to create new business models. Systems of insight. Now that's powered by the cloud. Why is the cloud important anyway? Because it's instantly available, infinitely scalable, insanely inexpensive, and drop-dead easy. It's the reason that the startups that we just heard from have the computing power of a Fortune 500 company. That changes the game, even if you need $500 million for your startup. And it introduced SaaS, software as a service. And SaaS is a revolution from somebody who's been in IT for 40 years because it decreases spend, it increases speed, it increases security, it makes you more scalable, and it ensures that your software is always state of the art. That's a huge change in the software business. And it gives us speed to DX, speed to digital transformation, which is where we're all trying to go today. Now, there are three pillars of digital transformation. Customer experience, revolutionizing your operational processes, and changing your business model. Three pillars. So that's what I want to talk about. Now, today I can get SaaS for every business function in my company, from sales to accounting to marketing to customer service to e-commerce. I don't have to build it, I can buy all of it. When we did Travelocity, it was stone tools. We had to build it all. And I can get SaaS for every vertical: construction, healthcare, tech, pharma, government. So all of that's available. So should I rent? I don't have to build. I don't even have to buy. Maybe I should rent everything. Well, that's a big change. When I was at American Airlines, we coded our own payroll system. You would never think about doing that today. Today, I can transform every function or process in my company with SaaS. But should I? If you do that, how do you gain competitive advantage? Think about it. If I have the same software as everybody else, do I have an advantage? Well, yes. I can gain a cost advantage by digitizing functions. So if my competitor hasn't digitized HR or sales, and I do, I have lower costs. That's good. But competitive advantage comes through digitizing products like Netflix, getting rid of tapes, and creating streaming. That's a competitive advantage. When you digitize your product, Then you turn a caterpillar into a butterfly. Then your customer now gets lower spend, more speed, more security, more scalability. They're always state of the art. That begins a competitive advantage because you're giving those benefits to your customer. Now, why does digital transformation fail? Gartner says the number one reason is management is focused mostly on fixing process and not on fixing business outcomes. You have to focus on changing your business model. Do all that other stuff, reduce your cost, good idea, but change your business model. Let's talk now about new business models. There are 800,000 new startups in 2020, and established businesses play whack-a-mole against all of them because they're all biting your ankles, right? Look, the battle is decided if the startup gets the distribution before the incumbent gets the innovation. If you're in a land grab like we did with Kayak, we got the distribution. That's why we were worth $1.8 billion. So let's rework your business model. Take OPA, other people's assets. That's Uber. Uber looked at the limo business and said, we don't want to own cars, license cars, and service cars. Drivers can find us. We're just going to find clients, set prices, dispatch, bill and collect, add some amazing software, become the biggest limo company on earth using other people's assets. Leverage is no longer about ownership of assets. Today, it's about access to assets. You want to have an asset-less business if you can, right? How about OPI, other people's information? After we left Travelocity, which we took public for $1.2 billion, got together with a bunch of other guys, and we said, well, can we change that model? Yeah. Let's not do this. Let's not do that. Let's just create a brand, search for products, and book a ticket. And then we said, no, let's not create a brand. Let's use Google for search. And let's not book tickets. Let's send the customer to the airline. We only did one thing. Just one thing. Added some amazing software. What's Kayak? It's just a tiny, thin layer between the customer and the supplier, worth $1.8 billion, based on reassembling data streams. OPI, other people's information, right? ONI, outcomes, not iron. I worked with Honeywell a couple of years ago. Honeywell's been installing sensors for 100 years. Something fails, the red light goes on. But then you have to figure out, what does the red light mean? So they move from sensing to meaning. They hooked up a computer system that says, hey, compressor failure, AC shutdown in section one, that's good. But then they move from meaning to action, back up on, service dispatched, from sensing to meaning to action. That's an outcome. That's a much more profitable business model than turn on a red light. They moved up the value chain. How about LaaS, lighting as a service? Philips, the light bulb guys, went to Schiphol Airport in Amsterdam and said, we want to light the airport. They said, no, no, you're the light bulb guys. They said, no, we want a 20-year contract to light the airport. And they got it. They immediately installed bulbs that use half the power because they're paying for the power. Bulbs that last three times longer, they're paying for the bulbs, and now they recycle the bulbs at the factory and remanufacture them. They had the data to make that profitable. The outcome was lighting, not light bulbs. GE sells power by the hour, jet engines, because they have the data. GEICO provides individualized insurance based on the data from your car. John Deere and Dow guarantee crop output because they have the data to do it. How about over and over again, subscriptions? That's what SaaS is, right? Probably some of you remember the Book of the Month Club. That was maybe the first subscription thing ever. But whoever thought you would subscribe to razors and that would become a billion-dollar business? And guess what? They do a lot of it with data because every month they ask you, what else do you want? You know, you want some hair product? You want some more shaving cream? What do you want? How about other people's products? Well, isn't that what Apple did with music? They don't make music. They build a hub. They build a platform. Same thing with the App Store. How about other people's data? Caterpillar Tractor does that. They have 200 other people writing apps to help improve you as a farmer using Caterpillar products. All of these are enhanced product business models through connectivity. Because what makes as-a-service models work is connectivity, yes, but data is the most important part. The data you have and the data you collect. Because cloud-connected physical products are all about instant learning from your customers. So John Deere doesn't have to wait for the annual meeting to hear what the dealer thinks the farmer's doing with the tractor. They know all the time, because look at this tractor. It has a grain loss sensor, active yield, quality camera, and it's constantly reporting to Deere, who's using that data as a weapon. And then you can update the product on the fly. My Tesla gets better, suddenly has better voice commands, or it has more backup cameras, or voice SMS, all through improving software. Tesla's not the most reliable car, but it has the highest customer satisfaction, I think, because customers are continuously delighted by getting new software. And if you add AI, it gets more powerful. You can do predictive failure, adaptive diagnostics, condition-based maintenance. I spoke recently to the I-80 truck stop, biggest truck stop in the world in Iowa. They're now doing maintenance as a service by connecting to various truck lines, getting IoT data from the trucks, predicting when they're going to fail and fixing them when they pull in. So they're in the maintenance business in a whole new way. Or add GPS, and you can become DeWalt, who tracks all the tools on a job site, makes sure the tools don't leave, and if I need a tool, I can find it. That's tool finding as a service, TAS, I don't know what they call it. Add analytics. Kaiser Compress Soren has been making air compressors since 1919. Now they have, they have AS, pardon me, air as a service. They used to sell compressors, now they sell air. You don't have to pay to buy the capital expense of the compressor. They just sell you how many pounds of air do you need this month. Or DAS, dirt as a service. Komatsu, the heavy equipment company in Japan, they're using drones to come to your job site. They figure out how much dirt you have to remove, and then they use their remotely controlled drone diggers to remove the dirt and charge you by the cubic meter. Dirt removal as a service. Much more profitable than selling diggers. Sell dirt as a service. These models are more flexible, more modular, more scalable, and they're future-proof. You can also disrupt just by disrupting experience. Think about the experience of buying or using a product. That's how Nokia disrupted Apple. That's how Apple was disrupted by Spotify. That's how Yellow Cab was killed by Uber. That's how Gillette was injured by Dollar Shave Club, just by changing how we buy or use a product. That's another way to disrupt your competitors. All these businesses are about less capital and more speed. Less capital, more speed, but you say that's not fair. I have the factory, the supply chain, the sales force, the brand. Yeah, but maybe you're not easy. And companies like Uber are drop-dead easy. There's a saying in Silicon Valley, step one, install software. There is no step two. That's it. That's how easy these competitors are. That's how easy you have to be. So what's your new model? Last year I spoke to the Hartford Steam Boiler Insurance Company. They've been insuring boilers since 1866. I said, what are you doing now? They said, oh, we just moved into cybersecurity and we bought an IoT company. I went, wow. They're playing to their strength. They know industrial processes, they know inspection, they know how to measure risk, and they're comfortable with it. Of course they bought an IoT company. They're going to be 200 years old because they understand the core of their business and how to move it into the service economy. You probably heard this quote, Uber owns no vehicles. Facebook develops no content. Alibaba has no inventory. Airbnb doesn't own real estate. What do they own? They own the edge. They own the edge. You see, the edge used to be about being at first and main. The edge today is about being at the edge of the glass. Because the edge of the glass is where the customer is, whether they're shopping in the store or sitting in the chair at home. You've got to own that edge. Because the edge is where customer experience happens, and customer experience is another part of digital transformation. Apps rule the edge. Taco Bell gets 20% larger orders from the app than from the store. Why? Because all the products are in the app versus the 16 on the backboard. And nobody's pushing you from behind, you know, making you pick which taco you want. Amazon used to have those dash buttons. You could put them around your house and order. You could stick one on your washing machine and order Tide. They don't have those anymore because now they have an API. So your washing machine can order its own Tide whenever it wants from Amazon. What a lock. My printer already orders its own ink. My Brita orders its own filters. Replenishment as a service. Lock in your customer. Waze knows where you are when you're driving. It also knows if you're going to be stuck in a corner for 25 minutes, now it'll say, hey, there's a Dunkin' Donuts here. Why don't you get a coffee? Monetizing the edge. GM is selling space now on its in-car entertainment system. So suddenly a message will pop up and say, you know, you're about out of gas. There's an Exxon station a mile away. If you use your MasterCard, we'll give you free coffee. They get that by owning the edge. Convenience. How about voice? A huge customer experience disruptor. Listen to this guy.
Alexa, order toilet paper.
Amazon's choice for toilet paper is Angel Soft Bath Tissue.
That's cool.
It is cool, but it's also disruptive. Because if I shop for Amazon on the web, I get 20 choices of toilet paper above the fold. How many did she offer? Only one. What do you think it'll cost to be the one? You think search is expensive? Wait till you see as we move from e-commerce to v-commerce, how competition changes. How will you build voice into your products? And let's go back to AI for a minute, because I had an AI company the last 5 years, and the most important thing I found out is AI systems are learning systems. They get smarter all the time. So let's say your son has a car wreck. You'll have the conversation with him. Hopefully he won't have that wreck again. But if a self-driving car has a wreck, all the other ones learn how to avoid it with the next software update. Tesla has 10 billion miles of learning. Their cars are learning 24/7/365. If you don't have ML, you are behind. You may never catch up to your competitor who does. You have to add it to your mix as soon as you can, or you won't keep up. Now, what's important to understand is these services models are not handcrafted. You can use as a service components, and we heard some today. We just heard one for Zoom, right? You can add voice as a service to your product. You can add telematics as a service. You can add scanning as a service. But make sure you add it to your product so it's smart and connected and better than the competition. Look, if you don't like change, you're going to like irrelevance even less. We have to deal with change. We have to be like General Foch, who said, I'm hard-pressed on my might, right, my center is giving away. Situation excellent, I'm attacking, right? Because there's more change ahead. And maybe. You can't hide, and you can't hold it back. Do you know that Kodak invented the digital camera, but they never deployed it? And the day Kodak went bankrupt, Instagram raised $1 billion. Photography didn't go away, Kodak did. Because they didn't change. From one perspective, that's a disruption. But from another perspective, that's an innovation. Disruption, innovation, disruption. They're just two sides of the same coin. The only reason you call it a disruption is because you didn't do it. If you did it, it would be an innovation. But you didn't. So you don't have to wait for the dominoes to fall. You can act. What's holding you back? What's holding you back from changing your business model? Half of executives are dissatisfied with the state of innovation in their company. I'd encourage them to look in the mirror. What's their attitude toward risk? Do you avoid it, reduce it, transfer it, or accept it? In the 21st century, you have to take more risk. You have to experiment constantly, and you're going to fail. It's okay, as Jeff Bezos said, it's not an experiment if you know the outcome, right? We don't know the outcome. We have to experiment. Maybe we'll fail. And when you fail, kill projects, not people. The project failed. Bob didn't fail. Learn from it. Do it again. In this new world, we have to make faster decisions. We're all envious of the guys in Silicon Valley. They make decisions so very fast. It's kind of easy. There are usually only two of them. But in a big company, you launch an idea out there, and maybe marketing says it's a dumb idea, and IT says, well, we can't support that. And if you get through them, well, then service says they can't fix it, and manufacturing says they can't build it. And if you get through them, they bring out the big guns, because now it's time for finance and legal. And, well, it's just game over, right? It doesn't have to be that way. If you come together, you're smarter than any startup. You do have the factory, the supply chain, the customers, the brand. You just have to stop saying no. It's easy to say no to a new idea and go back to doing your email. You have to say yes. You have to work to get that new idea over the finish line. And you have to be more agile than you've ever been before. You know, a major U.S. retailer had a 19-month plan pre-COVID to get to curbside delivery. When COVID happened, they did it in 2 days. 19 months to 2 days. You can't unlearn that. And frankly, the boss won't forget that. So be more agile. Make faster decisions. And as you look at the potential of these services technologies, don't just recreate the past. Reimagine what the future can be. Look, we've had radio-controlled airplanes for years. I had one as a kid. And then, actually, a 16-year-old kid invented the first quadcopter. And somebody just recreated the past. They said, well, you know, we have these crop dusters, so we should have drone crop dusters. Okay, that works. 80% of crops in Japan are now dusted this way. But then somebody reimagined what the future could be, and they said, what can we do for the farmer that's new and different because we have this connected machine? And they said, we could add infrared, and we could detect where we need more fertilizer and where we need more water, and we could hook it into a weather system, and we could really help the farmer grow more crops, which is the outcome they want. That's reimagining. Because the last 25 years were about who could build things the cheapest, and the next 25 will be about who can build things the smartest. Customer experience, operational processes, new business models. That's what the new world is all about. To win, you have to connect your products. Use your data as a weapon. It is your most important and valuable weapon, what you learn from those connected products. Then connect that to a new business model and build the best customer experience ever. That's how you win. That's how you check the competition. If you use the as-a-service model, you can beat them, and you will. Thank you very much. And here's where you can get the slides.